HarperCollins and Harper Audio present The Addiction Inoculation, Raising Healthy Kids in a Culture of Dependence by Jessica Lahey. This is the author. A note before we begin. For a list of additional reading materials, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to harpercollins.com/audio/addiction inoculation. For my children and my students. Chapter 1. Hi, my name is Jess, and I'm an alcoholic. Hi, my name is Jess, and I'm an alcoholic. It has taken me such a long time to arrive at this sentence, to be able to put the word alcoholic in such close proximity to the word I, and to face the reality that no matter how diligent I am, I can't control my drinking and must live a completely sober life. 8 years on in my recovery, I'm grateful to be here beyond the shame, guilt, secrets, and lies. Now that my own relationship with addictive substances is well in hand, it's time for me to figure out how to prevent my children from having to travel the same path. I come by my addictions honestly, as the branches of my family tree hang heavy with substance use disorder. Some of my relatives favored moonshine, others wine and pills, but the one constant was secrecy. No one ever talked about it. They stocked up on bulk packages of peppermint gum and hid their emergency nips in the rafters of the basement workroom while pretending everything was fine and dandy. If questioned, we were all great. Thanks for asking. Nothing to see here. But there was plenty to see, even if we were not allowed to call it by its name. My family's native tongue was one of euphemisms, and I've never been a fan of the dialect. I was raised to understand that the proper term for passing out was taking a nap, and voicing concerns about a relative's drinking or pill use was a punishable offense. In the midst of all this obfuscation and chaos, the only thing I hated more than alcohol was the lying. By the time I hit adolescence, I'd begun to understand the scope of my extended family's problem with addictive substances, and I was scared to death. Drugs and alcohol threatened my identity as a perfectionist, an overachiever, the goody-two-shoes' eldest daughter, so I bolted to the abstinent end of the substance use spectrum and held on for dear life. I was sure of one thing in the way only teenagers can be certain: I would never grow up to be like them. Except I did. Single-minded determination to thwart my genetic legacy did not come with operating instructions, so I made the rules up as I went along. It's no wonder I ended up at the bottom of a wine bottle in my 40s. Even so, I was one of the lucky ones. I emerged relatively unscathed from my years of substance abuse. As a not-yet or high-bottom alcoholic, I did not have to lose my family, friends, or career in order to find my way out, and for that, I am immensely grateful. I married a man who shares my genetic predisposition for addiction, though he escaped that fate himself. We have two boys, and while we can't do anything to mend their genetics, we can promise them this: the language of shame, secrecy, and euphemism will have no place in our home. I was a middle and high school teacher for 20 years and spent the last 5 years of it teaching some of New England's most addicted children in an inpatient drug and alcohol rehabilitation center in Vermont. I was their writing teacher, charged with helping them find the words to pin their deepest, darkest monsters down on the page, to expose those ugly and manipulative beasts to the light and identify their parts. When the work was hard, I wrote alongside them, and together we learned how to describe the events that led all of us to that small rehab classroom, from our first use to our last hurrah and everything in between. No one wants to grow up to be a drug addict or an alcoholic. That's simply where some of us end up, so desperate to escape the discomfort of being who we are that we pick up that first smoke or drink. I first drank because I was anxious to impress a girl I admired, but I wish I'd known then that she first drank because she disliked herself so much that she wanted to disappear. My friend Celeste, not her real name, and I were alone in her house one weekend night when she came up with a plan. We'd take one sip out of every bottle in her parents' liquor closet. It would be enough to get drunk, but not enough to get caught. I went along with her plan, but most of my sips were pretend. Hers, however, were in earnest, and the night went about as well as one might imagine. She got drunk, I got tipsy, she threw up, I held her hair back, cleaned her up, and put her to bed. Celeste and I went our separate ways after middle school, but in an internet-fueled fit of nostalgia, I searched for her. I'd expected to find her Facebook page, images of her face on some law firm website, or a mention of her marriage in a local paper. What I found instead was her obituary. It offered no information on her cause of death, only that she'd died at 35, leaving her parents, siblings, and an ex-husband, and in lieu of flowers, they asked for donations to the American Liver Foundation. Facebook led me to her sister Anne, also a pseudonym, who told me that Celeste died of liver failure after a multi-year Leaving Las Vegas-style drinking binge. After a couple of failed suicide attempts, Anne said, Celeste chose alcohol as her surest path to death and drank as much as she could in order to get there as quickly as possible. The impulsive, funny girl I'd so wanted to impress in middle school grew into an explosive, erratic young adult whose pattern of broken relationships and uncontrolled mood swings culminated in a diagnosis of borderline personality disorder, BPD, at 18. Unfortunately, by then it was too late to save her. Her sister, who still does not fully understand Celeste's disease or suicide, did her best to explain it to me. If you look up the behaviors for BPD online, she was a classic case. Taken one at a time, the signs made her look like a typical teen, but when added all together, her diagnosis became clear. The problem was, nobody put all the pieces together until she was over 18, and nobody could force her to do any treatment. She used alcohol to self-medicate. It's no surprise that Celeste turned to alcohol to ease her symptoms. Both BPD and substance use disorder are characterized by emotional dysregulation and impulsivity, as well as feelings of emptiness, instability, and the inability to control moods. Many people with BPD turn to alcohol to medicate these symptoms, and because Celeste's BPD went untreated even after she was officially diagnosed, alcohol provided relief, at least in the short term. Celeste died just as my daily wine intake was ramping up. We were two alcoholics traveling two very different paths, but our reasons for drinking were the same: to self-medicate our emotional and psychological discomfort. Mine stemmed from anxiety disorder and compulsive perfectionism, Celeste's from her untreated borderline personality disorder, both predictable, well-known causes of alcohol dependence and abuse. Anxiety and substance use disorder are familiar bedfellows, especially in women. Women are twice as likely to have anxiety disorder as men, and women with anxiety disorders are more likely to use alcohol to self-medicate their symptoms. In fact, women with anxiety disorders are more likely to abuse alcohol than to drink normally, and progression from alcohol use to dependence happens faster in these women. I would have done just about anything to escape my anxiety, but all I had until I was diagnosed and treated in my 20s was alcohol. The only thing that kept me off Celeste's path was my abject fear of becoming an alcoholic, but over the long term, even that could not save me. Alcohol is such a trickster. It works so well in the short term to quiet the symptoms of both anxiety and BPD, but over the long term, it exacerbates both conditions. Alcohol compounded my anxiety and worked against the medication I took to manage it. As the consequences of my drinking began to mount up, they added to my anxiety, which made me want to drink more. Celeste found no cure at the bottom of her bottle either. Her BPD continued to eat away at her happiness and well-being, and once her marriage failed, she no longer drank to feel better, she drank to obliterate herself. I wish I'd known on that evening in her parents' house what lay ahead for both of us. I wish I'd been strong enough to tell her that I was not comfortable being a part of that evening's drinking experiment. I wish I'd told her that I loved her, that she had the power to make other people happy simply by being herself. I wish I'd known she was beginning a descent into a madness that would become full-blown mental illness. More than anything else, I wish she'd been diagnosed in time to replace her attempts at self-medication with real treatment that could have saved her life. We attended the same high school, but as we were no longer friends, I didn't know how much she drank. I was a teenage teetotaler. I pretended to drink from time to time, even pretended to be drunk once or twice just to fit in. But mostly, I was the perpetual designated driver, responsible for making sure everyone else got home safely. I was a dependable source of mints and gum and the keeper of the car keys. In my second year of college, I went all in on sobriety and righteous self-satisfaction and trained to become a peer drug and alcohol counselor. I was that annoying holier-than-thou twerp my college's health services sent in to re-educate busted frat boys. Picture a 20-year-old Jess standing at the front of a dank, beer-soaked University of Massachusetts fraternity common room on a sunny Sunday morning. 30 or 40 grumpy young men take their seats on the damp and sagging furniture and snicker as Jess mounts her colorful educational flip charts and illustrative diagrams on a portable aluminum easel. For the next hour, she uses every trick in her very short book to sway the hearts and minds of these floridly pre-alcoholic young men while they attempt to keep themselves awake with coffee, fidgeting, and mental plans for next week's kegger, the one Jess will most definitely not be invited to. I learned everything about the science of addiction, but nothing about my own relationship to it, let alone how to defend myself against it. I could explain the biochemistry of sober to shit-faced with my pointer and a diagram. 20% of the ethanol in their cheap kegged beer or vile house punch is absorbed in the stomach before moving on to the intestine, where the other 80% escapes into the blood. Once it hits the liver, an enzyme called alcohol dehydrogenase breaks the ethanol down into acetaldehyde, and another enzyme called aldehyde dehydrogenase breaks the acetaldehyde into acetate, which leaves the body in the breath that condenses on the frat windows and the pee they use to write their names in the snow. I graduated from college with my sobriety intact, but I'd started to fall in love with the romance of drinking, and romance turned out to be the thin edge of my addiction wedge. There's a scene in the movie Raiders of the Lost Ark where Marion, the headstrong, willowy barkeep, wins a drinking contest against a massive Nepalese man. After many, many shots, he passes out, but somehow, Marion is completely sober as the crowd cheers and she gathers up her winnings. I loved that scene. Marion is so badass, she can drink a huge man under the table, then go on to put her long-lost love, Indiana Jones, in his place with barbed banter. In reality, of course, that could never happen. If the big guy is unconscious, she'd be long dead, but who cares? I love the idea of being able to outdrink the most hardened locals in a far-flung bar. Later, when I read the Outlander books, the hook was set. Jamie and Claire savored their soothing drams of whiskey by 18th century firelight and drank down their stream-chilled stone jugs of cider after haying in the August heat. I'd always thought that hard cider tasted like carbonated rotten hot dogs, but the taste wasn't really the point. I wanted to drink deep from the romance, the taste of Jamie and Claire's life in the Scottish Highlands and the mountains of North Carolina. It was simple and beautiful and good, and until I could have their life, their drink would do. The romance began to wear off in my 30s, and I was 32 when I realized I might have a problem, or at least the very beginnings of one. My husband and I lived in Cambridge, Massachusetts, where I worked as a nanny in exchange for an attic apartment while he completed his medical fellowship. My older son was 5, the little girl I nannied was a toddler, and my second son was an infant. I never drank during the day, but I really looked forward to the moment I handed the child over to her mother and I could open that evening bottle of wine. I drank while cooking elaborate meals for my family, and I drank while we ate those delicious meals. At some point during those years, one bottle of wine split between the two of us was no longer just the right amount, and that made me nervous. Not nervous enough to throttle back my drinking, but nervous enough to ensure I always had a backup bottle. We did not really have the money for multiple bottles of wine, but I rationalized the purchase somehow. I cooked a lot of things that required a splash of wine and provided an extra glass or two or three for me, And for a while, that solved the issue of supply and demand. My emerging problem, however, was disposal. I had to be careful, very, very careful. One afternoon, I was leaning up against the brick wall of my son's elementary school at kindergarten pickup, and another parent, a woman I barely knew, approached. She clearly had something to say and was having trouble getting it out. She leaned toward me, took a breath, then opened her mouth and closed it again, opened her mouth and closed it once more. I braced myself because she was hemming and hawing so much, I thought she was going to tell me my son had been mean to her kid.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.